Welcome to this week's Springwater service. I'm glad you managed to locate us. How's your week been? Well, it's been quite a momentous one, hasn't it? In the big world outside. What with the presidential election finally playing out, the exciting news that a vaccine is just around the corner for the coronavirus. And of course, we've remembered those that lost their lives in the great wars and those who continue to lose their lives serving their country and protecting us all. As we all sit here in the second week of lockdown, it's very easy for us to feel disconnected and isolated from the real world around us. I do hope this morning that you feel connected and part of the church family here at Springwater. So this morning the service is going to take the shape of a time of worship, which the Colam family will lead. A time of prayer, which Judy will lead us in. And then Grace is going to share some words after that. So before we go on, let's pray. Lord, it says in your word, worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honour and power. For you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created. Father, you are a great God, and we have much to thank you and worship you for. Father, we just pray that we will feel like a family this morning, even though we are separated physically. Father, we thank you that it's possible to actually, record this service and transmit it. Father, we thank you that the virus does not have to create barriers. Let's join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We'll now move on into a time of worship.
is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy.
Today I'd like to start our prayer time by reading Psalm 23 from the Passion. The Lord is our best friend and our shepherd. We always have more than enough. He offers a resting place for us in his luxurious love. His tracks take us to an oasis of peace, the quiet brook of bliss. That's where he restores and revives our lives. He opens before us pathways to God's pleasure and leads us along in his footsteps of righteousness so that we can bring honor to his name. Lord, even when your path takes us through the valley of deepest darkness, fear will never conquer us, for you already have. You remain close to us and lead us through it all the way. Your authority is our strength and our peace. The comfort of your love takes away our fear. We'll never be lonely, for you are near. You have become our delicious feast. Even when our enemies dare to fight, you anoint us with the fragrance of your Holy Spirit. You give us all we can drink of you until our hearts overflow. So why would we fear the future? For your goodness and love pursue us all the days of our lives. Then afterwards, when our lives are through, we'll return to your glorious presence to be forever with you. Father, we come to you today with thankfulness. Thankfulness for you, that in these dark and worrying times, we know that you are with us, that you are watching over us and walking alongside us in the difficulties and concerns of this year. We thank you for the good things that you have provided, that we are safe and have homes and food, for people who care about us, and we're thankful for our church and families. We thank you that we can have technology that enables us to gather together, even though we can't be together physically. We pray for those who are not as fortunate and pray for comfort and provision for them, for the refugees, for people in war-torn countries, the lonely, the marginalized people, for those who are having to lock down with abusers, for those who suffer from depression, and for the elderly who are shut in. Father, we also pray for the doctors and nurses throughout the world. I pray that they would have comfort and rest and that you would protect and bless them and their families. And we pray that a COVID vaccine would not only be available speedily, but that it would be effective long term and that it would be available to all. We pray for the families who have lost loved ones and that you would be their comforter and their peace. We pray for the people in our congregation and villages. We pray that you would protect them and provide for their needs. We pray for Guido and John in their search for work. We pray that you would provide way beyond their expectations and soon. We pray for Anne and Derek, Jules and her mum, Rosemary, Lindsay's mum, Martin, Chris and Rosemary, Robert, Karis, and any others who are struggling with health issues. But mostly we thank you for being our Father who cares for us and watches over us always, night and day. Amen.
Let's pray for Grace as she leads us to explore scripture and some personal reflections that hopefully for us as we listen will resonate in our hearts, impact us by the power and presence and counsel of the Holy Spirit, and help us as we seek to become more like Christ and also follow the way of Jesus and rest on the Father. Father, I thank you for Grace, for her willingness to step into this place, for her sharing her heart, her life, her insights. Help us to be receptive to the words that you are releasing through her, Father, and to have your way amongst us. And as words impact our minds and our hearts and take us on a journey with you, would your Holy Spirit hone us, Father. Lord, I thank you for her. Do more than she could ask or imagine. Bring all the provision that she needs for the days and the weeks ahead. And for us, Father, that we would be honed. And for Dave and Grace as a couple and for their children, Father, I pray for that over-encircling presence, that saturation of your Holy Spirit with the resources, the shalom, the strength, the fellowship, or the fullness of heaven for them. Would you rip open the storehouse of heaven and pour it down upon them and guide and lead us now. We give it to you and we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
So this morning I wanted to talk on, entitled it God's Journey. God's Journey, His Way, or Our Way. We're all on a journey, aren't we, with God. Our life is a journey. And God is journeying with us. Sometimes God asks us to do something which seems impossible. He asks us to do something which is hard for us to accept. We're going along, life is good, life is easy, and suddenly something in our life happen that we find really hard to take? How do we react when those things happen? Do we run away from God? Or do we run into Him? I think the message this morning, God is asking us to trust Him, to run into Him, not to run away from Him, because God is faithful. God always keeps His promises. And this morning I wanted to have a look at the story of Abraham and Sarah from Genesis. So we're going to look at some of the passages in various chapters of Genesis to illustrate what I am wanting to say, what I really feel that God is wanting to say. So Genesis chapter 12, verse 1 to 7. So I'm just going to read that. God told Abraham, "Leave your country, your family, and your father's home for a land that I will show you. I'll make you a great nation and bless you. I'll make you famous. You'll be a blessing. I'll bless those who bless you. Those who curse you, I'll curse. All the families of the earth will be blessed through you." So Abram left just as God had said, and Lot with him. Abraham was 75 years old when he left Haran. Abraham took his wife Sarah and his nephew Lot with him, along with all his possessions and people they had got and gathered, and set out for the land of Canaan, and arrived safe and sound. And God appeared to Abraham and said, "I will give this land to your children." Abraham built an altar at the place that God had appeared to him. So this was the first mention to Abraham from God that he would have children. So that was at the age of 75. And what a huge thing to ask Abraham to do, to leave his country and family. I wonder what emotions he was feeling. We read that he left his home just as God had asked, so he was obedient. He wasn't a young man, 75 years old. What faith he must have had. But I do wonder what questions he may have asked. Questions like, "What? Go where? At my age? Leave my home and family? You must be joking." I wonder what questions we would have asked, what emotions were going on inside of us. But he was obedient to God's calling. And how often have we been asked by God to walk with him and to trust him? Let's face it, it was a big ask. Starting a new challenge at the age of 75. But hey, let's not limit God. I remember some years ago, some of you may have heard of Selwyn Hughes, and he used to write these Bible notes, which I used to follow. And there was one thing that he said that really stuck with me, and it said, "Opportunity in every age." And I think that's true. Whatever age we are, there's opportunity. So let's not limit God. It's so easy to limit God, isn't it? So then we look at verse 7. He moved on from there to the hill country east of Bethel and pitched his tent between Bethel to the west and Ai to the east. He built an altar there and prayed to God. And then we move to chapter 15. God promises Abraham a child. We read in verses 1 to 5 that after all these things, this word of God came to Abraham again, this time in a vision. He says to Abraham, "Don't be afraid, Abraham. I'm your shield. Your reward will be grand." And Abraham said, "God, Master, what use are your gifts as long as I'm childless? And my manservant will get everything and will inherit everything. So Abraham was assuming that when God talked about him having a child, and he must have disbelieved because it was such an outrageous suggestion at that age he was going to have a child, that the inheritance would actually go to his manservant. And then God's message came and said, don't worry, because in those days, apparently, ancient documents demonstrate that a man could adopt one of his male servants to be heir and guardian of his estate. And it would seem that Abraham contemplated doing this. So here we see Abraham saw a loophole. And a little bit further on, we'll see Sarah, his wife, think something similar. I wonder how often when God speaks to us that we hold on to that promise, but we think it's going to happen right now. And sometimes we get frustrated, don't we? And we think this is never going to happen. So we try to work out a way that we can make this promise come into being. It's such a temptation. And then we go on that actually another 10 years had passed and Sarah tried to force God's hand and make the promise come true. And in verse 16, chapter 16, we see Sarah, Abraham's wife, hadn't yet produced a child. She had an Egyptian maid called Hagar. And Sarah got so fed up with waiting for this promise to happen. And she was so desperate to have a child. And she felt God had seen fit. She had given up. God had seen fit not to let her have a child. And she said to her husband, Abraham, sleep with my maid. Maybe I can get a family from her. And Abraham agreed and slept with Hagar, Sarah's maid, and produced a son. And of course, things didn't work out very well. Sarah's maidservant did have a son, but it didn't turn out well for Sarah. So Sarah tried to work out God's plan. She saw that loophole, didn't she? She realised that Hagar could sleep with her husband and make God's promise come true. But it's hard, isn't it, when we've been promised something and we don't have a clue when it's going to happen. And when you've been promised something, particularly by God, it's, God, when is it going to happen? But God says again, walk with me, journey with me, trust me. So we get fed up with waiting and decide that we'll do things our way. We end up making our own plans. We know God's timing is perfect, but we lose trust and try to work things out because we're fed up with waiting and wonder why sometimes it all ends in disaster. We know that verse, don't we, that says God's ways are not our ways. And God's thoughts are not our thoughts, and that God's timing is always perfect. But that sometimes means that we have to be really strong and be faithful, because we know God is faithful. When we try and work things out and force God's hand, it's really not the brightest thing to do, is it? We're doing things in our own strength, and things don't work out well when we try to do things in our own strength. But again, God is saying, walk with me, trust me, I know what I'm doing. Again, a little bit further on in Genesis, when Abraham was 99 years old, God showed up and said to him, I am the strong God, live entirely before me, live to the hilt. I'll make a covenant between us and I'll give you a huge family. Overwhelmed, Abram fell flat on his face. So here again, we see God is still promising Abraham a child. He was first told at the age of 75, and now he's 99. God says, I'll make nations from you. Kings will issue from you. I'm establishing my covenant between me and you, a covenant that includes your descendants, a covenant that goes on and on, a covenant that commits me to your God and the God of your descendants. And it goes on to say, Sarah, I'll bless her. Yes, I'll give you a son by her. Oh, how I'll bless her. Nations will come from her. Kings of nations will come from her. Abraham fell flat on his face and laughed, thinking, can a 100-year-old man father a son? And can Sarah, at 99 years old, have a baby? So Abraham was overwhelmed and fell on his face. I don't know about you, but after this long wait, my response might be, really? Are you serious? You've been telling me this for so long, I've given up expecting it to happen. It says he fell on the floor laughing. I can just imagine him belly laughing at the suggestion, maybe even rolling on the floor, or maybe not. At 100 years old, he may not have got up. So he didn't believe it would happen through Sarah. He assumed God actually meant God would bless them through the son of Abraham, who he had had through his servant Hagar. But God had to say it to him again. No, Abraham, you will have a son through Sarah, your wife, and you will name him Isaac, meaning laughter. So God visits Sarah exactly as he says he would. God said to Sarah what he promised. Sarah became pregnant and gave Abraham a son in his old age. And at that very time he had said. So God had planned this. He knew exactly when Sarah was going to become pregnant. He had set a time and a place. And God can do that for us. He knows exactly where he's taking us. He says, walk with me, journey with me. I have a place for you. I have promises for you. I have the timing also. Be faithful and trust me. Abraham calls his son Isaac, and when his son was 8 years old, we read Abraham circumcised him just as God commanded. So Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born. Sarah says, God has blessed me with laughter, and all who get this news will laugh with me. Whoever would have suggested to Abraham that Sarah will one day nurse a baby? Yet, here I am. I've given the old man a son. And we read that the baby grew and was weaned. Abraham threw a big party on the day Isaac was weaned. If this wasn't enough, God hadn't finished with them yet. There was more to come. Because we read further on, after all this, God tested Abraham again. Abraham must have thought, yes, God, what now? Abraham said, yes, yes, I'm listening. He said, take your dear son Isaac, who you love, and go to the land of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains that I'll point out to you. My goodness, what another big ask. What were the emotions that were going through Abraham's mind? It doesn't say anything about Sarah at this point. She must have been absolutely outraged. Why? You know, that she would be asking, I would be asking so many questions. I mean, no mother expects their child to die before they do. And I have to say, speaking from personal experience, Dave and I lost a child. It's hard. It's very hard. And at times, you want to question God. What are you doing? You're asking too much from me. But we don't know the questions they asked. All we know is that it says, Abraham got up early in the morning and saddled his donkey. He took two of his young servants and his son. He split the wood for the burnt offering. He set out for the place God had directed him. And on the third day, he looked up and saw the place in the distance. God told his two young servants, Abraham told his two young servants, stay here with the donkey. The boy and I are going over there to worship. Then come back to you. What was going through the boy's mind, I wonder? It doesn't say how old he was, but that walk they went to the place that God had appointed, must have filled him with anguish. A father who had waited so long for this precious, precious son was asked to sacrifice him. What was Sarah thinking? She must have been desperate. Or did she have enough strength to trust God? Did she really think God would actually carry this plan out? But again, God is saying, trust me, walk with me, let me journey with you. I will show you along the way. I will make things clear to you along the way. But you have to stay close. You have to walk with me. Run into me. I will give you the strength. I will give you all that you need for this journey. That was definitely true for David and I. Having lost a child, God was with us. We were young. God gave us the strength. People used to say, how do you stay positive? How can you trust God after this? It was hard, but God did give us the strength. And he provided us with another child, not to replace Abigail, who we had lost, but a beautiful child. And we had to stay close to God, and he did give us the strength to come through. So we read, Isaac said to Abraham, his father, Father, yes, my son, we have flint and wood, but where's the sheep for the burnt offering? Abraham said, Son, God will see to it that there's a sheep for the burnt offering. And they kept on walking together. They eventually arrived at the place to where God had directed him. Abraham built an altar. He laid out the wood. Then he tied up Isaac and laid him on the wood. Abraham reached out and took the knife to kill his son. Isaac said to Abraham, his father, Father, yes, my son, we have flint and wood, but where's the sheep for the burnt offering? Abraham said, Son, God will see to it that there's a sheep for the burnt offering. So they kept on walking, and they arrived at the place to where God had directed him. Abraham built an altar. He laid out the wood. Then he tied up Isaac and laid him on the wood. Abraham reached out and took the knife to kill his son. Wow. I find it really hard to imagine what must have been going through Abraham's mind right then. Probably his heart was racing. I wonder if he was saying, come on God, you've got something up your sleeve here. Please show me quickly. Or Abraham must have had such strength and such faith. He was walking with God. He was definitely walking with God. He was on that journey. God was on that journey with him. He must have had huge faith and huge trust. Yes, just as he was about to kill his son, just then an angel of God called to him out of heaven, Abraham, Abraham, yes, I'm listening. "Don't lay a hand on that boy. Don't touch him. Now I know how fearlessly you fear God. You didn't hesitate to place your son, your dear son, on the altar for me." Wow, what a relief. Abraham looked up. Just as he looked up, he saw a ram caught by its horns in the thicket. Abraham took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering instead of his son. And it says that Abraham named that place God Jireh, or Jireh. Not quite sure how you pronounce that, but it means God sees to it. And that's where we get the saying, on the mountain of God, he sees to it. The angel of God spoke from heaven a second time to Abraham. "I swear God's sure word, because you have gone through with this and have not refused to give me your son, your dear son, your dear, dear son, I'll bless you. Oh, how I'll bless you. And I'll make sure that your children flourish like stars in the sky, like sand on the beaches, and your descendants will defeat the enemies. All nations on earth will find themselves blessed through your descendants because you obeyed me." So at that very moment, when the promise to make Abraham a great nation seemed well on its way to fulfillment, the greatest threat came. He was commanded to take his son to the land of Moriah and offer up his entire future as a burnt offering to God. At the last possible moment, God intervened and a ram was substituted. Once again, the promise was preserved, and once again, God was proven faithful. I wonder, what has God been asking of you? Has he given you a task that you feel is just too much? Sometimes things land on us out of the blue, so unexpected, that take us by surprise. Sometimes it's a complete life change. But you know, we can know God's peace. Even when God takes us through a traumatic time, we can know his peace and his love. We can feel like a mother bird flapping her or wrapping her wings around her chicks. God can take us into that secure place where we can feel comforted and we can find rest and we can find peace. God just asks us to walk with him in this journey. Whatever journey we are on, whatever we have to face in our lives, even if it's a life-changing situation, God's there. He hasn't deserted us. But God is saying, run into me, walk with me, journey with me, trust me. Just as Abraham had to trust God and rely on God and believe that he knew where he was taking Abraham and Sarah. He knew the timing. He knew the place. And God provided that much-loved son that Sarah wanted, even though it seemed absolutely impossible. So whatever task we're facing, whatever promise we're still waiting for that God has promised us, he will be faithful. God always keeps his word. Let's just pray. Father, we thank you for the story of Abraham and Sarah. Although you asked so much from them, you stayed faithful. They stayed faithful to you. They not just did that physical journey that you set for them, but also the journey of their life. You provided for them, even though they had to wait and wait, and they must have thought this was never going to happen. But you stayed faithful, and they stayed faithful to you. So I pray for each one of us that whatever it is we're facing, whatever hardships we might be going through, that you are faithful. And I pray for each one of us that you will give us that strength that we need to walk with you, to journey with you. Father, we just thank you that you care so much for each one of us. You want us to stay close to you and to journey with you. Father, we need your help. But we thank you for Abraham and Sarah, for their obedience and their example. And we just ask that you will be with each one of us in whatever journey each one of us are on right now, that we will stay faithful and that we will continue to keep on this journey with you. We ask that in your name. Amen.
I hope you're able to take something away from our short time together this morning, something that will encourage you and sustain you in the week ahead. Now normally at this time we would take up an offering, obviously that's not possible at the moment, but if it's particularly for anyone in the church family would like to make a contribution, then please head over to the church website and locate the giving page. Do keep an eye out for the church newsletters that are being emailed regularly. They do keep you up to date with the needs of the church family and practical matters and the meetings that are taking place. The schedule is pretty well the same as it was last week. Of course, most of those events are via Zoom. So I hope you have a good week. Before you go, let's speak out the final greetings that Paul gave to the Corinthians. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forevermore. Amen.